Hello guys, this is a video on William Blake, 1757 to 1827. Remember to study the years of authors along with the names. Blake, you might know, was not only a poet, but he was also a painter. Poet and painter, he was the son of a successful London hosier and a dissenter. His father and Blake were both dissenters, influenced by the Swedish religious philosopher Immanuel Swedenborg. Blake was influenced by the Swedish religious philosopher Immanuel Swedenborg. That becomes important later. Blake never went to school and was educated at home by his mother. He read widely in literature and languages. He was well-read, scholarly. At the age of 14, Blake was apprenticed to an antiquarian engraver. Old topics were engraved by his master. Engraving is painting and etching on metal sheets. And with the metal sheets, the printing will be done. So that art, antiquarian art, he learned at the age of 14. He was also influenced by Gothic art. At this time, his fascination with male nudity began. Nudity is associated with classical art and was appropriate in the late 18th century. It was the fashion in the late 18th century. Nudity or sexuality was an expression of Blake's views on the life and the times. This is William Blake, portrayed by Thomas Phillips. Blake married Catherine Boucher and the couple lived at Leicester Fields. Here, their neighbors included the wife of the artist William Hogarth, and also the artist Sir Joshua Reynolds. So one famous artist's wife and another famous artist were neighbors of Blake. These two, Hogarth and Reynolds, epitomized neoclassicism, which Blake rejected. Blake was not a neoclassical artist. He was a romantic artist. And in poetry, Blake wrote Poetical Sketches. That was his first book, published by Blake's friends in 1783. Poetical Sketches was published by Blake's friends. In 1789, he published Songs of Innocence. That is the gentlest of his volumes of lyrics. The Book of Thale illustrates his early mysticism. Tyrael was written in 1789, and it was the first of his elaborately symbolic writing. The Book of Thale, Tyrael, these were early works. Immediately after Songs of Innocence. 1789, year of French Revolution, is the year of publication of Songs of Innocence. Now, Songs of Innocence initiated Blake's series of illuminated books. There's a series of books that he wrote that are called illuminated books. These incorporate the identification of ideas with symbols. The identification of ideas with symbols, which could be translated into visual images. Ideas are represented in the illuminated books as symbols, and these could be visual images. Illuminated books were also written with illuminated ink, which was used by medieval scribes when they copied manuscripts. These inks made of vegetable dyes were very bright. Songs of Experience appeared in 1793. Songs of Innocence, 1789. Songs of Experience, 93. And a combined edition of the two came out in 1794. The title was Songs of Innocence and of Experience, showing the two contrary states of the human soul. The two contrary states of the human soul are shown in the books. That is in that title. The poems in this volume contrasted the world of pastoral innocence and childhood, pastoral innocence and childhood. These are meek virtues of the lamb in the poem, The Lamb. This is contrasted with the world of adult corruption and repression. Those are the dark forces of energy in the tiger, in the poem, The Tiger. So the lamb and the tiger show the two contrary states of the human soul, innocence versus corruption. Look at Blake's engraving for the poem, The Lamb. Little lamb, who made thee? That is the opening line, if you remember. Last line is, little lamb, God bless thee. Blake's dislike of human authority and his radical sympathies led to his friendships with William Godwin and Thomas Paine. There were two radical philosophers, William Godwin and Thomas Paine. Blake became friends with them. And his radical thinking was reflected in his writings about religion, French Revolution, etc. during this period. Blake sympathized with the revolution and disapproved of Enlightenment rationalism. He disapproved of or criticized Enlightenment rationalism. He supported the revolution. He also disapproved of institutionalized religion. And also the institution of marriage, he disapproved of. What kind of marriage? Marriage in its conventional, legal and social form. Marriage in its conventional form, Blake disliked. His unorthodox religious views, as well as political views, were also unorthodox. Blake's unorthodox religious views derived partly from Emanuel Swedenborg. I mentioned him before. He was a 1688-1772 philosopher. 17th and 18th century. And Swedenborg was also criticized by Blake. Blake was not a blind follower or anything. And the criticism of Swedenborg is particularly evident in Blake's Marriage of Heaven and Hell. Blake wrote The Marriage of Heaven and Hell in reply to Swedenborg's book, Heaven and Hell. The Marriage of Heaven and Hell came in 1790. It was his principal prose work. Remember, The Marriage of Heaven and Hell is a prose work. It appeared in 1790 along with his engravings. And it was written in imitation of biblical prophecy. The Marriage of Heaven and Hell was written in imitation of biblical prophecy, in the manner of biblical prophecy. It was an expression of Blake's intensely personal, romantic and revolutionary beliefs. He had a very personal and radical set of beliefs, which was expressed in The Marriage of Heaven and Hell. The title is an ironic reference to Swedenborg's Latin book on afterlife called Heaven and Hell. He cites and criticizes Swedenborg several times in the book. The book describes the poet's visit to hell, a device adopted by Blake from Dante's Inferno and Milton's Paradise Lost. The book, The Marriage of Heaven and Hell, describes the poet visiting hell. This device was adopted from Dante's Inferno and Milton's Paradise Lost. And it is in Marriage of Heaven and Hell that Blake says, Milton was the devil's party without knowing it. The Blakes moved to Lambeth in 1793. Lambeth books, he wrote here. At this time, he began to shift his poetic voice from the lyric. He had just finished writing Songs of Experience. And from the lyric mode, he changed to the prophetic mode. And here he began his work on his prophetic books. Here he also did his most famous engravings, including those for the Book of Job and for Edward Young's Night Thoughts. Blake's admiration for the graveyard poets such as Edward Young gradually waned. At first he admired them. Gradually his admiration waned. At first, he made engravings for Edward Young's Night Thoughts. He's a transitional poet, if you remember. The Lambeth books are Songs of Experience, The Marriage of Heaven and Hell, Visions of the Daughters of Albion, America, a Prophecy, and Europe, a Prophecy, The First Book of Urizen, etc. Lambeth books are Songs of Experience, The Marriage of Heaven and Hell, Visions of the Daughters of Albion, America, a Prophecy, that is a prophetic book, The First Book of Urizen. The prophetic books are a series of lengthy, interrelated poetic works. They are lengthy, long poems, interrelated, drawing upon Blake's personal mythology. Blake had developed a personal mythology. And this is called mythopoeia. Drawing upon Hebrew and other mythological sources, he developed his own stories. And among the prophetic books that deal with Blake's mythopoeia, the most important are two, Milton and Jerusalem. Milton, a poem in two books, and Jerusalem, the emanation of the giant Albion. Milton, a poem in two books, to justify the ways of God to men. That is the full title, written at the beginning of the 19th century. The most famous part of this poem, Milton, is when Blake makes Milton, the poet, return to earth. And in the person of the living poet Blake, Milton corrects the spiritual error glorified in Paradise Lost. The most famous poem of Milton, the prophetic book, is that part when the poet Milton is returning to earth and through Blake correcting the spiritual error. What is the spiritual error? Glorifying Satan. The preface to the poem Milton includes the famous short poem Jerusalem. That is not this second prophetic book. These two are two different poems. The last and the longest of the prophetic books is the epic, Jerusalem, the emanation of the giant Albion. Albion is universal man in Blake's mythopoeia. It's a complex account of Albion, torn between the forces of imagination and the forces of natural religion. Albion is torn between the forces of imagination and natural religion, not institutionalized religion, which Blake disliked. Blake's personal mythology. In the Vision of the Daughters of Albion, Blake introduced the figures of his personal mythology. Urizen, a symbol of restrictive morality, who is also appearing in America, a Prophecy. Then there is Orc, the arch rebel. Along with the ideas of marriage of heaven and hell, these symbols are developed in Europe. And the Book of Urizen, the Book of Ahania, the Book of Laws, the Song of Laws, etc. These are all books where Blake develops his personal mythology. Urizen has been expelled from the abode of the immortals and has taken possession of man. Urizen has been expelled from the abode of the immortals and he has taken possession of man. Laws is the champion of light and the lord of time. Orc is a symbol of anarchy. You don't have to remember every single thing, but just remember, be familiar with the names. Urizen, Orc, Laws, etc. Blake's depiction of Urizen in the painting The Ancient of Days. All these names and stories are drawn from Hebrew and such mythology. The whole sequence of Blake's mythology is an inversion of Milton's Paradise Lost, which Blake denounced partly for justifying the evil committed by man. Blake admired Milton, but he denounced Paradise Lost for justifying the evil committed by man. Blake's criticism of Christianity is strongest in Europe and the Song of Laws. Even though he criticized Paradise Lost, he also criticized Christianity. The Four Zoas, another book, appeared in 1797. The four Zoas are Urizen, representing reason, Urthana, representing spirit. They are like the four elements or something, four levels. Luva, representing passion. Tharmas, representing body. Similar to William Blake, there is another poet, our Sri Aurobindo. He also talks about higher mind, illumined mind, some other mind, you know, levels of consciousness, levels of human existence. Blake and Aurobindo, I don't know if they can be even compared. They can be, probably. Look at the depiction of Albion in an engraving by Blake. This is an illustration of the epic Jerusalem, emanation of the giant Albion. You can see male nudity here, symbolically employed. Blake's last works. In 1803, after an unsuccessful association with his patron, who was his patron, one William Haley, Blake settled down in London for the rest of his life. Remember, he was not in London. Here he finished his prophetic books. The Ghost of Abel is a minute poetic drama that he wrote at this time of 70 lines. It questions the views of Byron. Auguries of Innocence. Byron came later, of course. Auguries of Innocence. Very famous book, which contains the lines, "To see a world in a grain of sand, heaven in a wild flower." Remember? Auguries of Innocence contains a series of paradoxes which speak of innocence juxtaposed with evil and corruption. Innocence juxtaposed with corruption. Same as Lamb and the Tiger. The Everlasting Gospel is a religious book that presents Jesus not as the traditional messianic figure. He is not the savior or the messiah, but he is a supremely creative being above dogma, logic, and even morality. He is a supremely creative being rather than the supernatural messiah. Like medieval craftsmen, Blake designed, engraved, and produced his own works. Blake was a mixture of extremes in both thought and work, profound as well as naive. Blake's vision of the contradictory forces beneath the appearance of human civilization mirrors the intense political turmoil of Europe and the New World in this period. Blake, remember, was a radical in his political views. Do not think all his religious poetry is without politics. Blake's vision of Lamb and the Tiger, or of contradictory forces beneath human civilization, actually mirrors the intense political turmoil of Europe and the New World in this period. Blake's interest in legend and antiquity was revived in the Romantics' rediscovery of the past. When Blake was interested in legend and antiquity, later Romantics were also interested in the past, especially in the Gothic and the medieval, as you can see in Gothic literature, which I will talk about presently in another video. Now, a quick look at the features of Blake's poems. Lyricism, at first especially. In his earlier poems, he employed lyricism, later prophetic books. Then, democratic sentiment. Naturally, he was a radical philosopher. Love of nature and simple life. Childhood. Home. These are all romantic themes. And an apocalyptic vision. Blake deliberately wrote in the style of the Hebrew poets. He was an apocalyptic poet. Blake deliberately wrote in the style of the Hebrew poets and apocalyptic writers. He envisioned his works as expressions of prophecy, like biblical prophecy, following the footsteps of Milton. You should also know that Blake's Apocalypse is a book by Harold Bloom. So that brings us to the end of this discussion on William Blake. Thank you. I hope you enjoyed this video.